In this video, I will mostly talk about my own scientific results for the first time. They concern selection rules for the second and higher harmonic generation in dielectric nanostructures. So one can predict the symmetry of the generated harmonic signal without solving any equations. Very simple. To understand this video, you need to know what second harmonic generation is and also the selection rules for the usual linear scattering, which I discussed in previous videos. See the links in the description. The key point of my work is that the nanoparticles are made of non-centrosymmetric material, so the nonlinear response is governed by the second harmonic susceptibility tensor of this material. There is also something quite non-obvious related to the tensor, so pay attention to this part. So we deal with three independent symmetries: the symmetry of the incident electromagnetic field, the geometrical symmetry of the nanostructure or metasurface, and the crystal symmetry of the material itself. What I actually derived are the multipolar selection rules. So we decompose everything incident field into multiples, and one can predict which multiples will be allowed and forbidden in the harmonic generation. But most real-life problems have axial symmetry, and in the most cases we only need the total angular momentum projection and parities. A short reminder, one can define the total angular momentum projection for any function. In this case, it is the vector function describing the electric field. We denote total angular momentum projection by M. The fact that a field possesses a particular M means that under rotation around the z-axis, the function doesn't change, except for acquiring an additional phase which depends on m. For example, a circular polarized plane wave has m equal 1 or minus 1, and a linearly polarized plane wave is a linear combination of both. Vortex beams can possess any well-defined m, for example 0, 2, whatever, and vector beams are just linear combinations of vortex beams with their opposite m's. Note that a linearly polarized plane wave has a certain parity under reflection. For example, it can be even in the screen plane and odd in the perpendicular plane. We assume that the nanostructure has rotational symmetry with respect to the z-axis. This symmetry is denoted by n. So, what happens during the second harmonic generation by a nanostructure? First, there is a linear scattering with selection rules that we already know from the previous video. Linear scattering knows nothing about the crystalline lattice. We assume that the birefringence effects are small, so the fields inside the structure, as well as the scattered fields, will have additional total angular momentum projections, which are multiples of the structure's symmetry order n. Then the magic happens. We use the usual perturbative formula for the second harmonic generation and write it as follows. Here E is the field inside the nanostructure, and P is second harmonic polarization. We use a trick. We will not describe the fields as they actually are, but replace them with the exponential functions, which have exactly the same symmetry behavior under rotations around the z-axis. In this way, we will not find the second harmonic fields themselves, but the symmetry behavior of the second harmonic fields. But what we are supposed to do with the tensor? Intuitively, you might want to say, okay, the lattice has a rotational symmetry, so we can describe the tensor in the same way as the nanostructure symmetry and at all possible multiples of this symmetry, but this is wrong. The tensor basically has, in a sense, higher symmetry than a lattice. For example, the gallium arsenide tensor transforms under all symmetry transformation of the sphere in exactly the same way as the spherical function y23. This is not obvious, it requires a lot of derivations, but it is true. However, we are not interested in all symmetry transformations, only in those related to the z-axis. In this case, it is much easier. We just need to write the tensor first in terms of tensor products of basis vectors, as shown here, and then rewrite each basis vector into cylindrical coordinates as usual. Voila, we have the tensor in cylindrical coordinates. Cylindrical basis vectors do not change under rotations, so only phi-dependent part, sine and cosine functions matter here. Let us rewrite them as exponentials, and here basically we have an answer for total angular momentum projections, because they are here in exponentials. So for gallium arsenide, it is only 2 and minus 2, not any multiple of 2, only 2 additional angular momentum projections. This is a huge difference, and it is sometimes written incorrectly in old papers. So the actual selection rules are more strict than they may seem. After that, all possible total angular momentum projections for the second harmonic can be written as follows. You may say, oh, but it is just the polarization. You should then take into account that these polarization currents excite eigenmodes on the second harmonic frequency, so the symmetry of the nanostructure itself plays roles again, but then the multiples of n from the nanostructure symmetry should be admixed again, but they are already admixed, so the answer doesn't change. If we consider surface second harmonic generation, the tensor there is in a sense invariant, and it was done before. It doesn't really add anything, so these rules were derived much earlier. But I want to point out again, the tensor symmetry is not the same as lattice symmetry. You will also find codes to transform the tensor and rewrite it into the cylindrical coordinates in the description. Of course, the tensor description works if the nanostructure is large enough, so we can describe the material as a tensor, but not the nanostructure as a huge molecule. It would be a different story. So, okay, now we have the rules for the total angular momentum projection. We only took into account the rotational behavior of all functions, but all three, the incident wave, the nanostructure, and the lattice, may also possess certain reflectional symmetry. It's easy to determine the reflection parity of the incident wave. It can be odd, even, or just not possess any parity at all. And we are only interested in nanostructures which do have this reflectional plane. If the nanostructure doesn't have any reflection symmetry, we don't have this selection rule. But what about tensor? It can also be even or odd. For this, the following table is useful. It lists the tensor components with respect to the reflection in the plane y equals 0. If you consider a different plane, the parity may be different, but it is not that hard to determine. Basically, you just need to look at the tensor products of Cartesian basis vectors again and their parities. So in the end, all the parities are multiplied in the equation. Don't forget that if you use materials from this video, you should cite them. See the references in the description. Now let us consider an example. Take gallium arsenide and an incident circular polarized wave. Let us consider a cylindrical nanostructure to better see the influence of the tensor. Then the possible outputs for the second harmonic are either 1 plus 1 plus 2 or 1 plus 1 minus 2. For the two terms of the nonlinear tensor, given 0 or 4. These are the only generated total angular momentum projections. Values 2 or 6 or 0 will not appear in this approximation, even though the lattice has low rotational symmetry. If we consider the linear polarized incident plane wave, which is a linear combination of two circular polarized plane waves, the possible total angular momentum projections take values from minus 4 to 4 with a step 2. So we have more total angular momentum projections. So they are less restricted than for circular polarization. However, the parity will be restricted. Basically, the generated waves should be odd under reflection in the y equals 0 plane because the tensor is odd. Finally, let us consider the example of a spherical particle, only because I have a nice picture for it, the shape doesn't actually matter. Of course, we have the enhancement of the nonlinear signal if we have a resonance at the fundamental frequency and at the harmonic frequency. The fundamental resonance is slightly more important in most cases, but it works only if nothing is prohibited by the selection rules. For example, here the electric dipole is prohibited. But why? Values m, 0, plus minus 2 and plus minus 4 are allowed, but for a dipole m can only be 0 because it should be less or equal to 1. So we could only get a dipole along the z-axis with m equals 0. However, this mode is even under reflection in the vertical plane, while the resulting field should be odd. Therefore, we can't have an electric dipole contribution here. Thank you for watching and don't forget to subscribe.